Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. Today, we're going to give the best information, the latest science on how to live a longer life, slow down the aging process, new research published in Molecular and Cell Proteomics from Brigham and Young University. That's just the beginning. We have 20 more articles to share with you also. These articles are all from peer-reviewed journals. They're all from respected institutions, but nowhere to be found in the mainstream media. That's why people tune in, because we're giving you things that can make a difference. Then I'm going to go to your calls. From what I understand from Jesse, we have a lot of people asking a lot of different questions, so I'll be interested to see what you're asking and how I might be able to help you. And because I don't know the nature of the calls nor how long it will take me, I'm not having a guest today. I was planning on doing our health special today, but new information and some new charts that we're creating are just now being worked on out of my New York office. Our scholars are researching this, and if all goes well, it'll all happen tomorrow. We'll post it. I'll broadcast it. I'll start the show with the broadcast, because it'll probably take about 45 minutes, maybe even the whole hour. Here's the good news. We deserve universal health care. No human being should go bankrupt because they can't afford to pay a medical bill. Nor should we have to decide what should I surrender this month. Should it be my food, part of my food, or not pay a utility bill, or meds, just so that I can afford some medical procedure as a copay, paying exorbitant fees. What this article, the most definitive article that I'm aware of ever written on the subject, will show, detail, proof, document, is that not only is affordable health care affordable, we will save at least $1 trillion a year, bringing back money back into consumers' pockets and the American government's bank accounts. So the whole argument from those who, both some Democrats and a lot of Republicans, is we can't afford this. It would cost us an astronomical amount of money. It's not true. Absolutely not true. But on the other end, many of the newer, more social Democrats, the younger ones who are more idealistic, and I respect that, I'm going to play a clip today from one of them. They're saying we need it no matter how much it costs. That's noble in its idea, but it's naive in its execution because it would be dead on arrival. So we're going to show them how to do this and the actual numbers. So all this is going to be on tomorrow's program with a chart. And the chart is just one of those wow charts. When you see it, you're going to say, wow. We've already sent an advanced copy of this off for proofing to Professor Michael Hudson, one of the world's greatest economists, Professor Joseph Stiglitz, who won the Nobel Prize in economics. We've sent it to a lot of people to ask for their feedback before we put it on the air tomorrow. So that's tomorrow. Every day this week, I have another original investigative report every single day. And we have five of them ready to go. So we're in expose the truth and empower people mode for the next 10 days. Just want to give you a heads up. Now, if you want to call in and go to our number and ask a question, I'm going to give you that phone number. I'm going to give it slowly, in case you have a question or you want to make a comment that's constructive that we all can all benefit from. Here's the number. So please write this down. Keep it with you. Our voicemail line is 862-800-6805. 862-800-6805. So we're going to play you a lot of little clips today. I think you'll find them interesting. And then you can call in after any clip and give your response. Whether you agree or disagree in part or whole, these all deserve a forum. I do not believe in censorship. If you disagree with someone, debate them. Hear them out. Listen to the best argument they can make. And then if you feel that you can do so, deconstruct their argument. That's what we should do. We shouldn't censor people because they're not the same color, or the same religious background, or the same political or, let's say, identity politics side of the issue. We're going to have four of these on today's program. We begin with the latest on health and healing. I'm particularly interested in how we can slow down the aging process. But Brigham Young University is looking at what we can do to help save hundreds of billions of dollars a year in the diseases of aging and what it costs people when they no longer are able to live a good life. And this was published in Molecular and Cellular Proteomics, and it offers us a glimpse into cutting calories. You've heard me mention this before. This is not the first study, but it's another confirming study. The researchers found that when ribosomes, the cell's protein makers, slow down, the aging process slows too. The decreased speed lowers production but gives ribosomes extra time to repair themselves. This is from the study. Quote, "The ribosome is a very complex machine, sort of like your car, and it periodically needs maintenance to replace the parts that wear out the fastest. When tires wear out, you don't throw the whole car away and buy new ones. It's cheaper to replace the tires." Okay. So what causes ribosome, R-I-B-O-S-O-M-E, production to slow down in the first place? In this study, it was caloric restriction. Now, I'll use myself as just an example to illustrate this. Anytime people have been at a retreat, they notice I'm never sitting down and eating. I'm conserving my energy because I'm sometimes doing 5 to 10 mini lectures and one big lecture every single day. The last retreat I did about 30 hours of lecturing in 1 week. And it's all based upon the principles of mindful awareness, meaning in this moment, what can we learn and what should be the discussion? I'll give you an example of what I'm talking about. We go out for a walk, a beautiful country lane. So many birds, the smells of different flowers, especially on the old roads, like honeysuckle. And then I stop everyone and I ask them a question. What did you just hear? I don't know. How many birds did you hear? I didn't hear any. Okay. What did you smell? Nothing. All right. Then we would walk, and I said, walk in silence now. And just be present. Don't allow thoughts in your mind. Just be present. And then we stopped about 100 yards further up. They had heard up to 11 different birds and had multiple different smells. When we're trying to multitask, which most people do, we're separating our energy. We're dividing a little into different areas. But when you have all of your energy focused in one area, that's when it's its most powerful. That's when the vibration's the strongest. And so when I'm lecturing, when I'm doing my energy work, I don't want any distraction. I want full 100% energy. So in the morning, around 9, 10 o'clock, I make myself this drink. And it's rather thick. And people call it, when they look at it, they say it looks like dirt. Well, it's a very, very powerful healing composite of nutrients. And I won't have any more food until maybe 7 o'clock in the evening, 6 o'clock in the evening. That's a long time. That's how much it sustains me. Sustains blood sugar, sustains energy, does repair. Now then, dinner's always something very light. Not a lot. And then that sustains me throughout the rest of the evening and into the morning and the workout, etc. So you see, this idea that we have to sit down to 3 square meals a day is nonsense. We have to have nutrients. The whole purpose of eating a meal is to get the nutrients from the meal into our body and nourish our cells, help cleanse, detoxify the cells, allow the natural biorhythms to occur, natural circadian rhythms to occur. Help in the detoxification process is crucial to keeping the cells safe. You can't do that if you're constantly eating. You can't do that if you're constantly oversaturating. Now, instead of your body feeling light and energized, it feels heavy. You feel bloated. And especially when you consider most Americans are eating unhealthy food to begin with. So if you need quality enzymes and probiotics and vitamins and minerals and antioxidants and phytonutrients, you're not getting it in the American diet. So then you're going to have a deficiency. Now you're not 20 years old, you're 40 or 50. And if you're in college and you're binge drinking, you're 70 biologically. So everything we do today manifests as a future karmic date. Now, what if you had a clock that would pop up right in front of you every time you started to do something that wasn't healthy, and it showed you exactly how much of your lifespan is being deducted in hours, minutes, days, months, even years? Would you then do it or not? And that's what it's so important to focus on. All right? So this is about caloric restriction. Americans have a real hard time with restricting calories because all the propaganda is to overconsume. All you can eat. Look how big this is. We got the meats. And all the other stupid little statements that entice us that somehow we need that. So we change a need into a want. I want that. I got to have it. I'm hungry. But you just ate. I know, but I want the dessert. But there's no room for the dessert. I don't care. All those extra calories can probably take 20% off your lifespan, 20% over a lifetime. That's a huge amount of years that you're losing. So here they found that by restricting calories, about 35% fewer calories, yet still receiving all the necessary nutrients, you extend your lifespan. And that's the key. The caloric restriction in this experiment are showing enormous energy boosts and suffering fewer diseases. So ribosomes, like cars, are expensive and important. They use 10 to 20% of the cell's total energy to build up all the proteins necessary for the cell to operate. And because of this, it's impractical to destroy an entire ribosome when it starts to malfunction. But repairing it means that on a regular basis that it'll continue to produce high-quality proteins for longer than they would otherwise. So that's important. Remember, food isn't just material to be burned. According to Dr. Price, it's a signal that tells our body and cells how to respond. So eat right, eat healthy, eat a plant-based diet, and your ribosomes will work for you. Fast with juices one day a week, and you extend the lifespan, and then have longer periods of time in between meals, and you expand the lifespan. Reduce calories, and you're going to live a longer life. From the Hospital de Mar Medical Research Institute in Spain, published in the Journal of Circulation, the Mediterranean diet with virgin olive oil can boost the good cholesterol. Now, a Mediterranean diet rich in extra virgin olive oil will enhance the cardioprotective benefits of high-density lipoproteins, or the good cholesterol, compared to other diets. And high levels of the low-density lipoproteins, the bad cholesterol and triglycerides, that's a type of blood fat, are associated with an increased risk of heart and blood vessel diseases. And the HDL, the high-density cholesterol, is associated with a lower risk because these lipoproteins help eliminate the excess cholesterol from the bloodstream. So, once again, when you're on the Mediterranean diet and you're drinking the extra virgin olive oil, and you don't have to have the extra virgin olive oil in cooking. I don't use it in cooking except the end. You could put it into brown rice or on a salad. But just get it into your body each day, and it can make a big difference. Also, from the University of Washington comes a new study that wormwood, now I always recommend wormwood for people with parasites, that it really works, but wormwood kills cancer cells in 16 hours. In fact, it was about 150 years ago, cancer was rare. But with the inclusion of processed foods and low-quality meat and dairy and refined sugars, the standard diet, disease and sickness sprung up in the body. Why? Well, because of inflammation. And to this day, most mainstream medical doctors and pharmaceutical companies dispel the notion that diet and lifestyle choices are related to cancer, but they're wrong. In fact, this year, 600,000 Americans will die from a largely preventable disease. But on the forefront of natural means to combat already developed cancer and allow the body to heal itself, a new derivative of the wormwood plant has made headlines. In a recent study published in Life Sciences, it was found that artemisinin, the derivative, coupled with iron, could kill 98% of breast cancer cells in 16 hours. Alone, the herb caused a 28% reduction in breast cancer cells, but partnered with iron, the duo almost completely eliminated cancer. And what may be even more interesting, normal cells were not negatively affected in this experiment with the treatment. And the issue with mainstream cancer treatment is that it attacks all cells, which are essential for life. The idea is, let's kill the cancer cells before we kill too many healthy cells and kill the person. Well, good luck with that. That's such a stupid way of thinking. But that's our current system. Also, an acidic system with a underactive lymphatic system is the best environment for cancer to thrive. And by consuming a predominantly plant-based live food and unprocessed diet, it's easy to alkalize and flood the body with vital nutrients necessary for healing. Now, mind you, we're only talking about one single nutrient. There's a whole lot of other nutrients that are important. But this is just one to show you the power that it has. And you should be taking everything synergistically and under supervision. And also from Jiangxi University in China, curcumin, that's the active ingredient in turmeric, helps to effectively ease inflammation and bowel disease. That's correct. Curcumin can help suppress the activation of dendritic cells, which play a pivotal role in the progression of inflammatory bowel disease. So this was published in Frontiers of Pharmacology. They reported that their latest study found that the total number of these particular elements which are present in colitis was lower among those treated with curcumin. And they didn't even use a large amount. So curcumin for irritable bowel and any other of the itises that you might have, colitis, diverticulitis. Also from Harvard, a new study reveals how mind-body medicine could cut healthcare costs. This is important. In fact, later this week, I'll be doing a new study that was based upon a Harvard board-certified physician's research and therapy about body-mind. And this study reveals how that works. So relaxation response techniques such as meditation, yoga, and prayer could reduce the need for healthcare services by 43%. That's important. This was done at Harvard and Massachusetts General Hospital that looked at participants in a relaxation response-focused training program. Now, we know already that a relaxation response, which is a very important deep rest, not only releases stress and anxiety, but also affects physiological factors like your blood pressure and heart rate and oxygen consumption. And the paper's authors noted that stress-related illnesses like anxiety and depression are the third highest cause of health expenditures in the United States after heart disease and cancer. And by the way, both of those are impacted by stress. And this was done at the Institute for Technology Assessment and the Benson Henry Institute. So this was published in the journal PLOS One. Quote, our study primary finding is that programs that train patients to elicit the relaxation response, specifically those taught in this technique, can also dramatically reduce healthcare utilization, meaning the more you distress yourself, the less like you are to end up having a disease and paying for that disease because you were stressed. And from Queen Mary University in London comes a study about the link between a high-fat diet, obesity, and cardiovascular disease. Obesity in a diet high in fat could lead to a harmful activation of the immune system that increases your risk of heart disease. So remember, I've been telling you there's no such thing as being overweight and healthy because though you can't automatically say that a person's overweight has a classically defined illness, the cells are this at the very, very finite level, meaning right down to the nanoparticle, they're manifesting disease, including heart disease and higher blood pressure and elevated cholesterol. And then all this, in turn, triggers an immune response, increasing your risk of a heart attack. And the findings could lead to new ways of targeting this inflammation to reduce your risk of heart disease. This was published in the Journal of Cell Metabolism. So, once again, if you're overweight and you're eating a high-fat diet, and that's the paleo diet, absolutely opposed to that. You know, and the high-protein diets are high in fat, and just the average American diet is high in fat. And from Shanghai Medical College comes a new study on the cannabinoids, and they found that what is called the cannabidiol is one of over 100 active cannabinoids in cannabis, and it accounts for 40% of the plant's extract and widely considered to be one of its most powerful constituents. Well, emergency teams and cardiac and stroke units may one day use this oil as a neuroprotective effect to prevent the onset of debilitating symptoms developing from stroke and cardiac arrest. So again, just so you understand, a cannabinoid from cannabis exerts a powerful neuroprotective effect and can soon be used in stroke and cardiac emergencies. Isn't that interesting? So there's also a new study from the University of Queensland, and this is in Australia, and the scientists in Brisbane have discovered a non-invasive ultrasound technology that fully restores memory functioning in 75% of the Alzheimer's test animals. Now, you're looking worldwide at over 50 million now and with dementia, of which Alzheimer's disease is the most common form, and it's going to just increase by tens of millions in the next several years. So it's just another way that it can be helped. That's the latest on health and healing. I'm Gary Null. We're going to take a break, and when we come back, we're going to go directly into some of your questions.
I live in Lower Manhattan. Since 9/11 happened in my neighborhood, I feel I've been drinking to excessive levels. What I need for you are two things: a long-term solution, a recipe that can reverse the damage I've inflicted on my liver, kidney, heart, even my little pinky toe. Second, do you have a short-term solution for when I have an overwhelming urge to drink? Do you have a recipe that I can take a particular ingredient that will take away my urge? Looking forward to your...
Okay, Danny, you've actually stated several different things. I will try to bring some positive input to them. First, there is no such thing as drinking too little alcohol. No alcohol is the only amount of alcohol we should be consuming. Every single glass of alcohol that you consume is going to take an impact because the alcohol in and of itself is extremely corrosive to the stomach lining, to the esophagus. It can cause GERD. It can cause gastric reflux. And it's killing liver cells and kidney cells, but you're not feeling the pain. Now, the liver can rejuvenate itself about 60%, providing it's given the right help. But it's also killing heart cells and brain cells. It creates massive oxidative stress. And it's very subjective because when you say drinking a little too much, what does that mean? You know, it's a completely existential concept. If you were to see how many cells die after having a single drink, a beer, would you then say that what you've been doing is moderate or is that excessive? So anything that puts the body into a highly inflammatory state and causes the cytokines to rush in and then causes other chemicals in the body to try to heal the damage done, then you're really speeding up the premature aging process. I'm talking about years taken off your life, not moments or hours or seconds. So first you have to have the mindset is, why do you drink in the first place? If it's to relax, if it's still with stress, if it's to dull the sensation of the realities you can't deal with, okay, that's understandable. But it does mean it's acceptable. I can understand why someone does it. That doesn't mean I agree with them. There are good quality, easy-to-do ways of dealing with stress. I just mentioned some. Journal writing is good. Being a citizen journalist is good. How would you do that? You would look at the world, you'd take on an issue, a single issue. And let's just say that the single issue you want to take on is how universal health care could work and could be affordable. All right, tomorrow when I do my report, you could download the report. It's all fully footnoted and documented. You could then write a piece about your own health and those that you've known since 9/11. And remember, originally, Christy Whitman, the New Jersey governor, lied and downplayed the significance of the dust and the chemicals in there. Everybody lied. You know, they all said, oh, it's not that harmful. As a result, I was there on the morning of 9/11. Many other people were there. We all did our best, what we could, to help other people. But think of all the people that went back day after day after day after day. I would later work with those people, a retired fireman. Was on full disability. A year on protocols, he was able to return to work. We actually went in and filmed him, putting back on his outfit and going back to the fire department. But what about all the people that didn't have the benefit of that? So now, had we had universal health care, all those people would have been able to have been helped without it bankrupting them. Because bankruptcy for the last 20 years has been either from medical bills or home foreclosure bills have been the first or second leading cause of bankruptcy. So the very fact that we've had tens of millions of people actually adversely affected is important. And take it always down to the story of the person on the street. Always start the story of what you're saying from the downside, not the upside, because the upside, you don't have knowledge, wisdom, spiritual intent trickle down. What you have is justification for greed and amoral, immoral behavior. And so you need to reverse that, and you can do that as a citizen journalist. I'm just giving you one example. You could take any other cause that you want to address and then do your homework. So now you're taking what you can't control, and you're setting that aside, and you're taking something that is in your control, how your perception of a particular cause can help you rebalance your own life. You're bringing clarity to people who have none, knowledge to people who are intentionally ignorant. So then that helps you. Then in the interim, when you feel like having a drink, just realize if you have a glass of green tea with lemon juice in it, and you drink it cold, the desire for alcohol is stopped almost in its tract. Chewing on an ice cube can do the same thing. Taking a B-complex, a high B-complex, especially with B6, 125 milligrams in niacin or niacinamide, the non-flush, that can also help. I've worked with thousands of alcoholics and people who have substance abuse, and you can turn off the cravings, but you have to have something more important to live for than acknowledging your pain. Because once you show your pain, you open a door and you go in, and every day, everything you're looking at then is filtered through the eyes of being a victim and the pain. And then you dull the pain with whatever substance you choose. Your case is alcohol, someone else is something else. So we don't have to stay a victim of the poor choices we've made. Can you cleanse and rebuild? Absolutely you can. Detoxification is the first stage. But having something vital to live for, having something when you wake up in the morning to feel good about yourself, what did I achieve that I should feel good about myself instead of waking up and looking at the world and thinking, oh, you know, it's too corrupt, everything is corrupt, no way to change it, so I'm going back to sleep or I'm going to have a drink. No. Every day that you're able to breathe and think, you're also able to construct something and share it with other people over the internet that is of a positive outcome, even something that we don't want to see. I recently had someone come up to me and say, I just saw your film, Poverty Inc., and it really disturbed me. And I said, good, because it got your attention about the nature of inequality. And the person says, yeah, it did. It did. I was unaware of this. So a person was disturbed by something, but also it opened the door to them, to a new sense of, what can I do about it? I didn't know this was going on. How can I remove myself from participating in this? You could do the same. Okay? All the best to you. Let's take another call.
Hi, I hope I'm not calling the Gary Null Show. My name is Francisco, and me and my wife have been vegan for a while now. The question I have for Gary is, I just wanted to find out if I wanted to make sure that I'm getting all the nutrients. Me and my wife are getting all the nutrients. What kind of blood work, or where can I go to actually just do this work and find out that everything is in order?
Okay, well, the best thing to do is you need to get two separate tests taken. The tests for a man and tests for a woman are different. I know there are people in our society who believe that everything should be the same. Well, good luck with that. But men and women are biologically different. Our hormones impact us in different ways. And once we know whether or not we're imbalanced in our hormones, imbalanced with our blood chemistry, imbalanced with the percentage of our body fat to lean muscle tissue, imbalance with the immune responses that we should have, all that then is important. But to do that, you're going to have to get a blood workup done. If you can get a blood workup, and they're not expensive, they're somewhere between $200 to $400 for a complete blood workup, then you'll be able to look at the blood workup or have someone who knows how to read a blood workup. It's very easy. And then they can tell you. And generally the blood workup will tell you whether or not you're in a range that's normal or you're high or you're low. If you're high or you're low, you can then have that checked. For example, if I was looking for a male and you're a male, and I would ask for maybe the male elite panel, And that for a female, the female panel runs about $270. I would look for fasting glucose. That would tell me whether or not you have imbalance in your glucose. You could be pre-diabetic and not know it. I'd look at your uric acid levels and your blood nitrogen levels, your bun levels and creatinine and the ratio. I'd look at the GFR and sodium, potassium, chloride and calcium and phosphorus and iron and total protein and albumin and globulin and bilirubin, and whether you have, what's the level of your alkaline phosphatase and the lactase dehydrogenase and aspartate, aminotransferase. These are all terms that they're measuring something in your blood chemistry. I want to know. I want to know your cholesterol level. I want to know your LDL and your VLDL, which is very dangerous if it's that elevated. I want to know your red blood cell count. Are you anemic? Are you getting enough iron? I want to know your hemoglobin level. I want to know your hemocreatin level and your mean levels on the hemoglobin concentrations. Those are just some of the things. If you're a female and you're suffering from weight gain, and you can't understand why, if your hair is falling out, especially the outer parts of your eyebrows, you might have a thyroid problem. So a comprehensive thyroid panel is generally around $200. And the male comprehensive hormone levels is around $300. And I want to check to see whether or not your testosterone is in balance or not. And I want to see a level of your T4, your free T4, your free T3, and your female basic hormone panel is only $75. But that tells me whether or not you still have a balance between estrogen and progesterone. I want to know what your testosterone level is. Women have testosterone. It's just not dominant. All these are intricate. And anything you do emotionally or physically or nutritionally can imbalance them. So the key is to bring them back into balance. So probably the best that I know in the country is life extensions. Just go to life extension, lifeextension.com, I would assume, and look at their blood panels. They get a lot of them, and that's what I would recommend. Okay? We'll take another call.
My name is Stan Alton, but I'm asking this on behalf of the many, many people who have osteoarthritic damage to major joints. The question is, are there any therapies, natural or experimental, which might regenerate cartilage tissue in especially in the hip joint? I mean, that's where I've lost a great deal of cartilage, and I'm close to bone on bone. Thank you very much, Gary, and very much appreciate how much you do for people in general through your medical knowledge and your wise counsel. Thank you. Bye.
Historically, we have been led to believe if you have arthritis, there's not a lot you can do except take some form of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory. These are COX-2 inhibitors in order to damage to some level and blunt the pain signals going from your brain from the tissue that is damaged. So the pain is still there, you're just not feeling it. The damage is still there, you're just not as aware of it. But if you're just the average person, you may not want to go that route because that's a deadly way. 60,000 Americans minimally, one report I saw, it was 500,000 died from taking one drug for arthritis, and that was Vioxx. In any case, arthritis in all of its forms really is just inflammation in one or more joints. And you're going to have all the swelling and the stiffness, and you wake up in the morning, there's pain. A lot of athletes have arthritis in their toes, the metatarsals, in their ankles, in the knees, because they've overtrained and they didn't care about a more holistic approach. And so the term arthritis literally means joint inflammation. And I don't care whether they call it any number of different conditions, it's still the same. It's inflammation, and it can hit your internal organs, it can hit your muscles, it can hit your bones, and in some cases, it's actually life-threatening. But it really impacts the quality of our life. It's been around a long time. It's not a modern disease. Archaeologists have even found in their studies that skeletons of Neanderthals and other prehistoric mammals, even dinosaurs, had arthritis. So I'm not going to go whether it's rheumatoid arthritis, which is an autoimmune disorder, or any other form of, you know, arthritis, gout, which is also a part of that, and juvenile arthritis and ankylosing spondylosis or systemic lupus or bursitis and tendonitis, myofascial pain. These are even carpal tunnel syndrome and fibromyalgia. And Reiter syndrome, these are all still in the same category. So how would I go about it? First, I would do a complete detox. And I would start by going on a plant-based diet, a healthy plant-based diet, because you could also do an unhealthy plant-based diet. And I would make sure that I had essential oils. You could use krill oil. You could also use olive oil and coconut oil and hemp oil. Those are your most important oils. I would take something that is a superstar turning off pain in the joints, and that's bromelain. Bromelain is an enzyme, and it stimulates the production of prostaglandins, and that reduces inflammation. I would also use chondroitin, C-H-O-N-D-R-O-I-T-N, chondroitin sulfate, generally around 1,000 milligrams. That supports strengthening the joints, ligaments, tendons. And then you want to make sure you get lots of oils in there because that helps lubricate it. And it also helps control the pain. Then glucosamine sulfate, G-L-U-C-O-S-A-M-I-N-E. And that's crucial for your bones, tendons, ligaments, and cartilage, and synovial joint fluid. Then N-acetylglucosamine, generally at 1,000 milligrams. And then MSM, which is a sulfur-based. And then I would use this sulfur at reducing inflammation. And then SAMe, generally at around 500 milligrams, is good. Sea cucumber is good. Silica is good. And trimethylglycine is good. Vitamin E is good. It's a very powerful and protective antioxidant, especially protecting your joints from damage from free radicals. And it increases joint mobility, generally at 400 units twice a day, and at the same time about 200 units of the tocotrienols. Boron, about 3 milligrams, is good, and it's required for the healthy bones and uptake of calcium. Calcium magnesium would go higher, generally at about 1,500 milligrams of calcium and about 1,000 milligrams of magnesium. Now, calcium and magnesium are good for a lot of other things, including heart regularity, but they're very good for this, along with vitamin D3 and zinc, generally 500 units to 1,000 units of D3. And I would also look at dimethylglycine, about 100 milligrams three or four times a day, and your free-form amino acid complex. That's important. I would also look at B-complex, pentothenic acid. In fact, mentioning pentothenic acid, I remember, this goes back to 1974. I get a call at my radio show, and I was on the air, and I couldn't take it. So afterwards, this call comes in, and says, Gary, and I said, yeah, this is Barry. He was talking about Barry Farber. I said, yeah, Barry. We knew Barry. I knew Barry. I've been on his show over on WR a lot. And he said, I'm sitting here on my kitchen floor. I got so much pain in my foot. My toe is swollen. I can't move. What do I do? He lived up at on Broadway, and I walked by his place every day, and we'd frequently see each other, and we'd go out and have dinner. But I went over to his apartment, and I took some vitamin, well, it was B-complex pentothenic acid, 500 milligrams. And I took a couple homeopathic agents, and I said, Barry, you're eating that meat. You can't do that anymore. That's creating uric acid, and these uric acid crystals are creating gout. So he said, okay. And after that, he became a vegetarian. He no longer had that pain. Anyhow, pentothenic acid's a big, big deal. That's vitamin B5. Generally 500 milligrams to 1,000 milligrams. And then B6, again, is by itself is big. That's important. And vitamin C and the bioflavonoids and vitamin K and D-L-phenylalanine. So those are some of the things that I would suggest. And definitely stay off all meat, all dairy, all caffeine, all coffee. And then if you want a superstar for an herb, boswellia, B-O-S-W-E-L-L-I-A. It's an Ayurvedic herb. It reduces inflammation. It doesn't matter what the source is, and this is made from the frankincense plant. It also helps restore blood vessels around inflamed connective tissues. And about 150 milligrams of boswellic tablets per day, and they can make a big difference. And cat's claw, ginger, and cayenne pepper also good. And nettle leaf is good. And borage seed oil is good. And curcumin is good. Okay? And you can actually repair the damage. It's not permanent. We'll take one more call.
Hi, this message is for Gary Null. This is Ray in East Northport, New York. I had a question about combining chlorella and vitamin C, that the vitamin C might release the metals, heavy metals, that the chlorella is trying to get out. I stopped taking a well-known multi that has that combination in it. Just wondering what your take was on that combination. Thanks, bye.
First of all, vitamin C in and of itself is a great chelator. Now, your best two detoxifiers for chelation would be cilantro and chlorella. If you take a chlorella powder or chlorella liquid, you would be 1 tablespoon. And then you could juice cilantro and maybe take a whole handful of cilantro and juice it, get a little bit out. And those two together with vitamin C are phenomenal for chelating. They don't neutralize one another, all right? So you're on the right path, and you would chelate about 3 times a day that way. Now, what we're going to do, I'll take more calls tomorrow. I look forward to it. I want to play Alexandria Cortez's testimony. And I believe that she is a young idealist who wants to do the right thing, and who wants to show that she cannot be controlled. Let's hope that she stays true to her intention not to allow the lobbyists that live in Washington just to control Congress, putting money in their pockets, that she doesn't get tempted and step over that and touch that third rail and lose her sense of objectivity. But at this moment, she's shouting out. She's getting the Americans, people's attention. Some like her, some don't, depending upon their political persuasion. And once I give my report tomorrow, I'm going to ask people in this audience, send the report to her office in Washington, as well as every member of Congress. They all need to see this. And why? Because I believe she has the courage, not the scholarship at this point, but she has the courage to bring scholarship to the public's attention, which allows those naysayers to be held at check. If you have proof, hard evidence, that we could fund universal health care without creating any debt whatsoever, actually saving money, then it negates their argument and gets more supporters on board. Here's some of her talking about this, what is going on in Washington, and this is the first time I've heard someone who is gutsy enough, and good for her, to stand up and tell the truth, because this is the truth.
Well, as we've seen, for me to be a pretty bad guy. So it's even easier for the President of the United States to be one, I would assume.
That's right.
Thank you very much. Let's play a lightning round game. I'm going to be the bad guy, which I'm sure half the room would agree with anyway. And I want to get away with as much bad things as possible, ideally to enrich myself and advance my interest, even if that means putting my interests ahead of the American people. I have enlisted all of you as my co-conspirators, so you're going to help me legally get away with all of this. So, Mrs. Hobart Flynn, I want to run. If I want to run a campaign that is entirely funded by corporate political action committees, is there anything that legally prevents me from doing that?
No.
Okay. So there's nothing stopping me from being entirely funded by a corporate PAC, say, from the fossil fuel industry, the healthcare industry, big pharma. I'm entirely 100% lobbyist PAC funded. Okay. So let's say I'm a really, really bad guy. And let's say I have some skeletons in my closet that I need to cover up so that I can get elected. Mr. Smith, is it true that you wrote this article, this opinion piece for the Washington Post entitled, "These Payments to Women Were Unseemly, That Doesn't Mean They Were Illegal"?
Well, I can't see the piece, but I wrote a piece under that headline in the Post, so I assume that's right.
Okay, great. So, green light for hush money. I can do all sorts of terrible things. It's totally legal right now for me to pay people off. And that is considered speech. That money is considered speech. So I use my special interest dark money funded campaign to pay off folks that I need to pay off and get elected. So now I'm elected, now I'm in. I've got the power to draft, lobby, and shape the laws that govern the United States of America. Fabulous. Now, is there any hard limit that I have? Perhaps Mrs. Hobart Flynn, is there any hard limit that I have in terms of what legislation I'm allowed to touch? Are there any limits on the laws that I can write or influence, especially if I'm based on the special interest funds that I accepted to finance my campaign and get me elected in the first place?
There's no limit.
So there's none. So I can be totally funded by oil and gas. I can be totally funded by Big Pharma. Come in, write Big Pharma laws, and there's no limits to that whatsoever.
That's right.
Okay. So, awesome. Now, Mr. Marabani, the last thing I want to do is get rich with as little work possible. That's really what I'm trying to do as the bad guy, right? So is there anything preventing me from holding stocks, say, in an oil or gas company, and then writing laws to deregulate that industry and cause, you know, that could potentially cause the stock value to soar and accrue a lot of money in that time?
You could do that.
So I could do that. I could do that now with the way our current laws are set up. Yes?
Yes.
Okay, great. Is it possible that any elements of this story apply to our current government and our current public servants right now?
Yes.
Yes.
So we have a system that is fundamentally broken. We have these influences existing in this body, which means that these influences are here in this committee shaping the questions that are being asked of you all right now. Would you say that that's correct, Mr.
Yes.
Marabani, or Mr. Shelby?
Yes.
All right. So one last thing, Mr. Schaub. In relation to congressional oversight that we have, the limits that are placed on me as a congresswoman, compared to the executive branch and compared to, say, the President of the United States, would you say that Congress has the same sort of standard of accountability? Is there more teeth in that regulation in Congress on the president, or would you say it's about even, or more so on the federal?
In terms of laws that apply to the president,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's just almost no laws at all that apply to the president.
So I'm being held, and every person in this body is being held to a higher ethical standard than the president of the United States.
That's right, because there are some ethics committee rules that apply to you.
And it's already super legal, as we've seen, for me to be a pretty bad guy. So
right.
It's even easier for the President of the United States to be one, I would assume.
That's right.
Thank you very much.
Okay, good for her. It's telling the truth. Look how this applies. Right now, there is a campaign underway to attack every single person who is making any challenge, no matter how legitimate and supported by evidence, against vaccines, mandatory vaccines. We did the report early this morning. I'll broadcast it later in this week. And it shows the following. 7 million adults, family members, have a child with autism. That's just autism. Now, autism is on a spectrum. It's a disorder, not a specific disease, generally affecting the mitochondria, different parts of the brain. Now take a look at all the children who do not have autism, but have other conditions like learning disabilities, delayed learning, speech, due to vaccines. Look at children who have defective immune systems with chronic allergies and asthma and inner ear infections, and due to vaccines. So here we have at least a minimum of 10 million adults. Let's say 5 million of them are women. We have a movement, I Believer, but somehow we don't believe these. Why not? And behind this are members of Congress that refuse to invite one of the top scientists who was engaged in a cover-up, has acknowledged that, actually have him hearing him saying it, on the MMR vaccine, especially in African-American children. He's not allowed to go to Congress to tell what he knows because of these lobbyists that she's referring to who put money in legislators' pockets to get them reelected, but then the legislator does the bidding of those who give him the money. And that's why after years of Representative Posey from Florida and Brian Hooker from California, Dr. Hooker, who exposed this, that he has not been forced to testify under oath because it would expose the entire corruption of the entire CDC from top to bottom. And they know that. So what about the health of young boys, especially African-American boys? That's irrelevant. Well, it's not irrelevant if you're the parent. And if you have an autistic kid, you're going to spend the rest of your life having to take care of him. Well, they're not important. They don't give money to legislators. So the back end of what she's saying is that every member of Congress, with a few exceptions, is controlled by special interest groups. Well, then what is this farce of all this voting and all this stupidity by all these asses on television pretending they know something about human nature when all they are propagandists at Fox and MSNBC and NBC? These are dancing clowns. Yeah. But they're never criticized. No. And we take them at face value depending upon our political positioning. Yes. And we actually trust these legislators. Big mistake. Big mistake. That's what she's saying. At least that's my interpretation of it. We'll have more tomorrow, including our special in-depth report on affordable care, how we can make it real. Have a nice day, everyone. Mm-hmm.